guys? Okay, I guess I am audible. Wow, I blend in well. I think you guys got the memo about my uniform, yeah? Okay, before I start off, I have a disclaimer, and also I have a confession. The disclaimer being, I'm not here to talk about my job and what I do. For that, we have the networking session, and I have my colleagues, Peter and Dani, right at the back. So you can reach out to us during the networking session and ask about what DPDHL does, et cetera, et cetera. I'm here to talk to you about my passion. Yeah? Secondly, I have a confession. Believe it or not, I am a millennial. Just about made it by a few months. So I'm a millennial. I'm like you guys. And what does a millennial mean? We are people who want to do things. We want to change the world, and we want to see it happening. We want to make a tangible difference. At the same time, we like change. We like challenge. We don't like stability. However, this is my first job. I have spent 10 years in this organization. So clearly, there's something that's kept me going. What I'm going to talk to you about is doing well by doing good. Why am I here, right? So for that, I have to tell you my story. This is a picture. I guess some Indians can relate to it. 1993, 12th March, it was a nice sunny Friday. I was a student. I had taken a day off from school. My mom had taken a day off from work. And we had decided to spend a nice ladies' afternoon together in South Mumbai by the seaside. And post-lunch, we were just walking towards the seaside. Around 1:30, we heard a deafening bang. And for me and my mom, the next few seconds seemed like an eternity and the world stood still. She clutched on to me, and we both started crying. I don't know how long we stood like that, but we saw people running towards us. They were bloodied, blackened. There was shouting and wailing all around, and we didn't know what was happening. And I wanted to do something about it. I said, Mom, what do we do? And she said, you can't do anything. Just, and she was afraid for me, so she just held on to me. And I just felt helpless, and that's it. I mean, that feeling stayed with me. Okay. Sorry. Again, 2001, I was a college student. I was in my hostel. It was a nice Sunday, 26th of January, no classes, so we were just enjoying chat when I heard the news that a devastating earthquake had hit the west part of India in Gujarat, and many lives were lost. Again, there was this really, really hard desire to do something. So some of us got together, we did a fundraising drive, we did a donation drive, we put material together, and we sent it to Gujarat. I don't know whether it reached. I don't know whether it made a difference. And again, I was left with this feeling of, what can I do? What can I do that I make a concerted effort, something that leaves an impact? And DPDHL has allowed me to do that by giving me a framework and a platform to make a difference where it matters. And how did DPDHL start doing this? What is this Go Help about? Again, there's a little story I would like to share. I don't know how many of you know this guy here, but that guy is Carl Schwab. So he is the founder of the World Economic Forum, and this was way back in 2002 in Davos when he was addressing this big audience of world leaders, corporate honchos, and talking about the economics, etc., is when he posed a question to his very elite audience and said, how about you corporates get together with government agencies and authorities and use your core competence to make a difference? Somewhere, this thought hit home for our then CEO, and he decided to have a discussion with the UN. And this was way back in 2002. And there were some discussions going on. Things moved a bit. To your right is another picture. Now, if you look at it, you can't make out what it is. So this is Bam, Iran, 2003. A devastating earthquake hit. Many lives were lost. Now for you all, this picture doesn't share much. But for me, somebody who's from logistics, this is a disaster. There's a plane waiting on the tarmac. There is a vehicle right in the taxiway, and there are goods lying there. And this was the scenario that happened in Iran. And DHL, being a logistics company, we have an office almost in every airport. We are there. And that time, the authorities just reached out to us and said, hey guys, can you do something about this? We need help. It's chaos. We have these goods coming in. The countries want to help. They're sending in material, but the planes can't land. The tarmac is a mess. And that's where it all started. We decided, okay, let's do something about it, and let's do something about it in a proper manner. And that's where what we call as GoHelp started. Now, what is GoHelp? What we are doing with GoHelp is using our core competence in logistics, going out and helping communities wherever there is a natural disaster, and help them in their logistics of the relief good movements, people movements, etc. There are three phases to it. There is preparedness. So what does preparedness mean, essentially, is don't wait for the disaster to happen, right? You don't have to only react. There are some preparations that can be done, and that is a program called GARD, which is Get Airports Ready for Disaster. What we do with UN is we target countries which have been prone to disasters, which lie in remote areas, and we go and work with the airport authorities, the employees of the airports, and other agencies that operate at the airports, and train them to deal with the surge in load that happens in the aftermath of a disaster. Volunteers fly in, relief goods fly in, government officials fly in, and suddenly that small airport, which maybe dealt with 1,000 passengers in two flights in a day, faces an impact of 10,000 passengers flying in and out, and maybe 10 flights, and they're not ready for it. So what we do is we conduct a workshop, we help them prepare, and we make them create a process in which if that disaster happens, they are in a better position to react to it and to respond to it. These are the countries. We do this all over the world. We have three teams which are spread all across the globe, which go and help out. We do it in partnership with the countries, the governments, and UNDP. And we try and target places, as I said, where you see that there has been a disaster or there is a propensity. Next, I come to the response phase. So you are prepared, but natural disasters will happen. We can't control them. And lately, we've seen a lot of them happening, especially in this part of the world. What we do in disaster response team, essentially, is we're all employees of DHL. We're also trained. We're also trained to go and work in these airports and these warehouses, handle and manage relief goods, and then make sure in the fastest way possible we're able to get them to the affected communities. We work with, again, the government authorities, we work with UN agencies, we work with the militaries who are usually present, and we try and support them. Again, this just presents a geography of, you know, where all we have helped out. The last one is the recovery phase. So preparation, response, recovery. What is recovery? After the disaster has occurred, you've responded, you've helped out, the communities want to return to normalcy. They would want to rebuild their lives. And how can you help them? You can help them rebuild that by being there, by offering your expertise, your skills, or just offering your labor. What we do in this initiative is we go local, we give power to the local communities, to the local DHL offices present across the countries, and help them form their programs and help out, just like the way you do here in AIESEC. And I think people from South America, you would have heard of TECO. It's a Chile-based agency, and Habitat for Humanity. So we've worked with them. We help in offering our expertise, our skills, and also our time in helping rebuild, right? So I've shared with you what this GoHelp is about and how I'm able to pursue my passion, because I like to help, I like volunteering, and it has kept me going. But why is DPDHL, which is a big, huge logistics conglomerate, and obviously wants to make profit, it's a business, getting involved in this? What are they getting out of it? And this is where I want to share with you the concept of shared value. What does shared value mean? It goes back to the root of the concept saying that no individual and no organization operates in isolation. Whatever we do, our actions have a positive or a negative impact on the society and surroundings around us. So we have a choice. Either you do something good, or you continue to do what you're doing, and maybe it has a good or a bad impact. So if you choose to look into the concept of shared value, what it essentially says is you have to go beyond your immediate sphere of influence. For an organization, the immediate sphere of influence is the employees, right? The managers and the people around, right? Who you work with. The second sphere of influence then becomes your customers, your partners, your vendors, etc. And the third sphere of influence, the larger one, is the environment you operate in. There are agencies there, the people, the community that you eventually impact by the means of their action. And what shared value says is, if you're able to pursue your business, to achieve your economic needs, but that at the same time, you're able to use your core competence to do something that impacts the community, you are making a positive difference. I move away from DHL. I've done a lot of talk about DPDHL. I want to share with you an example of Kirin, okay? I don't know how many of you know Kirin. I think beer drinkers. So Kirin is a Japanese beverage company, yeah? They're known for their beers. And in 2011, when the tsunami happened in Japan, northeast part in Fukushima, I'm sure you've heard the name, it was in the media a lot, was one of the worst impacted areas, also because it had two nuclear reactors and the radiation leaked, because of which the community around, the industry around Fukushima was severely impacted. Economy was affected, and of course, livelihood of the people. Kirin also had a plant there. And like the way the Japanese do, they're known for their thorough research, they did a research and they found out that their factory was located in an area where there was no impact. It was way beyond the sphere of influence of the radiation. However, the stigma stayed. Obviously, you don't want to work in an irradiated area. You know that once the genes get mutated, it can impact generations further. So the stigma was there. And how do you get the people to realize that, no, it's safe to work there? And, you know, it's fine. And that's where Kirin hit upon this unique idea. What they did was, from the factory that was located in the agricultural area around, they used the fruits from the area and created a new drink. And the new drink, they branded in such a way, proudly displayed, made in Fukushima, it is safe. They got their board of directors, everyone, they did a media event to endorse it, and they shared with the people that this is safe, it's made here, we are having it, we're all fine. And that rung in a great message to the people. It helped the economy, and it helped the company, and they were able to do good business. So that's what shared value is about. So essentially, what it tells you is that if you want to do good, you can also do well. So it's not that when you get involved in social projects, etc., it's keeping you away from the core. If you want to do good and you want to do well, use your core competence and help out where it's needed the most. With all this talk, I now want to share with you how DPDHL does this. And essentially, as I was talking to you, I spoke a lot about Go Help, right? Well, there's also Go Teach, and there's Go Green. So what happens in Go Teach and Go Green? I don't know if you know, but DPDHL Group employs about 500,000 people. It's one of the top 10 employers in the world, which means a whole lot of people. Well, if you have so many people, they have their children, right? So if you're able to do a campaign on championing education in which you not only just support your employees' children, but you reach out to the communities further, you are making an impact. So that's what we do with Go Teach, and we work with Teach for India also. What we do with Go Green essentially is, again, we are a logistics firm. We use a hell lot of fuel. We have planes, we have vans, we have trucks, we have ships, which means we really make an impact to the environment. But if we take a step back and also measure our impact, become conscious, look at our carbon footprint, and take steps that can make a positive difference, then we are trying to work towards the concept of shared value. So that's what we've been trying to do. Now, I think I've done a whole lot of talk, so I would like to just show you a video on all the things that I shared. One of the main things that I wanted to share about is in April this year, we had an earthquake in Nepal, and I want to share what our team and we did in Nepal this year.
On that day, we actually wanted to acknowledge one of our employees who was retiring as of 1st May. We were at a place called Gampe Dada, which is around 20 kilometers away from Kathmandu, next to the Bhaktapur city. We were all enjoying the picnic. People were dancing, people were playing. Suddenly, the whole hill started shaking. We just saw dust all over the city. In front of our eyes, we saw a couple of houses just falling off. It was something very scary, and it took us nearly 3 hours to come back because the roads around the Bhaktapur area were completely damaged. There were no casualties from our employees' side, but three of them actually lost their family members.
This particular deployment was unique in the sense that the United Nations Office for the Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs called upon us as the very first choice. The very first message that I received from UN OCHA was less than 10 hours after the quake saying, "You guys, can you deploy?" This is the first time that happened.
I was deployed with my buddy Zam. When we arrived, we are unable to land. So I and Zam was circling the air for like 2 hours. Finally, when we are able to land at Kathmandu, we realized that relief cargoes are lying around everywhere.
In the region where there's no big international airport, so it's a challenge. Every time we deploy, we face the same challenges: space, equipment, and resources.
Once you unload one plane and you drop all the cargo on the ground, you can't use that space again until it's been moved. So then another plane comes in and you've dumped that cargo on the ground, then you can't use that space either. And then it gets worse as you can't get to move around to get any of the cargo out.
This is the point where DHL was a great partner for WFP, supporting us on the technical operation, on the tarmac, on the ramp, and actually on the cargo flow to manage the overall emergency response.
So we've partnered with the World Food Program and DHL to offload humanitarian supplies off the aircraft, get them from the ramp where they're staged initially, down here to the World Food Program Logistics Cluster humanitarian staging area, where they can be distributed throughout the country.
You can't move them with your muscles. You have to have equipment, which is one of the problems. In a country like Nepal, the equipment is pretty scarce. You've got an old forklift here that's probably 25 years old, and it's lacking power and friction. But we have to use what we've got.
There's always a different challenge, and there's always a different approach. There is no fixed modus operandi. We need to rely on the assessment of the very first team that arrives.
It was really challenging at the beginning. Dusty conditions that we work in down here and the old equipment that they've got. We're lucky enough now that we've got a couple of new forklifts.
This is my 7th DRT deployment. No two disasters are the same. Never the same.
On May the 12th, we were in a meeting. During that meeting, a big earthquake happened.
Initially, we weren't really sure what was going on.
Everyone ran outside of the buildings to get away from it. It was a very long 30 seconds.
Then the locals said, yeah, it's an earthquake. So we all got out of the forklifts and just waited until it finished.
We went to say our goodbyes to the authorities. Not to my surprise, the authorities said that DHL was by far the best supporting unit at Nepal Airport.
I can only be very positive on the cooperation with the DRT team. Without DRT for the last few weeks, it would have been a big mess.
Other than other NGOs or military, I'm actually proud to say that DHL is the only company on ground in time of disaster, the only company is there to help in terms of logistics.
I've never met such a professional team together with the US Air Force partners helping us operating and managing the whole cargo floor.
DHL's disaster response team has been a phenomenal help, but we're integrated every step of the way. They're very professional, very efficient and smart, and most of all, friendly and great attitudes. So it's been an absolute joy to work with them.
I just would like to thank each and every one of the DHL network. We have made a difference in the community that we live in under the Go Help banner with the DRT team deployment here in Kathmandu.
Read some of the text because quite a few are far, but essentially it just says that we were there for 33 days. We are full-time employees, but there we are just volunteers. There were tremors every second or the third day. We worked through the tremors, and even when the earthquake on the 12th May, the second earthquake struck, the entire team had a choice to either withdraw and go back because we all have families and full-time jobs, but the team decided to stay, and we were there, as I said, you know, for 33 days, and it's been by far, I was there too, and it's been by far one of the most fulfilling experiences, you know, that I've ever had. So before I close, I want to share two statements. The purest form of satisfaction that you can ever get is when you go and help someone who does not have the capacity to help you back. He or she has nothing to offer you in return. And the greatest legacy that you can leave is if you come into the world, and when you leave it in a slightly better shape than it was when you came in. Thank you.